Well, somebody say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Somebody say, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
If you love the Lord, give him a great big clap. Offering. And once again, today we are celebrating Angela's Bat Mitzvah. Let me tell you a few things about Angela. She has been an active member here at the Tabernacle for 5 years. And about 2 years ago, I had the privilege of marrying her and her husband, Leonardo, right around the time of Rosh Hashanah, the time of new beginnings for both of them. As a matter of fact, they met here at the Tabernacle, and hallelujah, eventually they were married here as well. Angela has a very, very powerful and far-reaching ministry, very extensive ministry here at the Tabernacle. Some of you may not know this, but obviously she is a member of the worship team on the flag team. She also writes articles for the Temple newsletter each and every month. She is one of our Bat Midrash teachers. She hosts a Torah study once a week. I think it's on Tuesday evenings at her beauty salon in Monette, Missouri. Kenny Wilkinson teaches that Torah study. She also, if you remember, she is the director of the Purim play each and every year. And we all remember the Purim play, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
And there was a villain in that story, and his name is Haman. But hallelujah, God raised up two people for such a time as this, and that was Mordecai and Esther.
Yay!
You remember that? Not only is she the director of the Purim play, but she's also very involved in other drama productions during the year as we observe the Feast of the Lord. Furthermore, Angela is in charge of the Facebook page for the Tabernacle. And she and Leonardo recently took and returned from a trip to Israel, which I believe is part of Hashem's preparation for her Bat Mitzvah today. And they love God's Torah so much they even brought back their own Torah from Jerusalem. Glory to God. And without a doubt, Angela has the heart of Ruth, the one who said to her Jewish mother-in-law, Naomi, wherever you go, I will go. Your people will be my people. Your God will be my God. Hallelujah. And she is honoring the God of Israel today. Now let me also reiterate this, that Messianic Bar and Bat Mitzvah is for believers in Yeshua. How many of you are believers in Yeshua? Raise your hand. Hallelujah. Whether born Jewish or not. Romans 11:17, Paul tells us Gentile believers have been grafted into the olive tree of Israel. Paul writes in Ephesians 2:12-13 that non-Jewish believers now share in the commonwealth of Israel and are fellow citizens with the Jewish people. And Ephesians 2:14-15, Rav Shaul writes that Yeshua has broken down the middle wall of partition and created in himself the one new man. I ask you, how many of you are glad today we are all one in the Messiah? Hallelujah. So having said that, let the Bat Mitzvah begin. Let's all get into place. Let's all stand, please, and let's find the Shema on the overhead.
Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad, Baruch Shem Kedosh, Malkuto, Le'olam Vayeh.
Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Blessed be his name
Hafta et Adonai Eloheka, Bekol Levavka, Uvekol Nafshika, Uvekol Moladeka. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your might. V'ahavta l'reacha kamocha, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu, Elohei Avoteinu, Elohei Abraham, Elohei Yitzchak, Elohei Yaakov, Ha'el Hagadol, Ha'gibor Ha'alokah. Thank you. All of my time.
being sent forth. The Torah portion is Numbers 13:1 through 15:41. The Haftarah portion is Joshua 2, verses 1 through 24. And the Brit Hadashah, or New Testament portion, is Matthew 10, verses 1 through 14. Today I'll be chanting from the Torah, Numbers 13, 25, and 26. Vayashuva mitor haaretz miketz arba'im yom vayelku vayavo el Moshe ve'el Aharon ve'el kol hadat b'nei Yisrael El Mibar Paran Kadesha Vayashivu Otam Devar Va'et Kol Ha'edah Vayarum Et Puri Haaretz. They returned from spying out the land at the end of 40 days. They went and came to Moses and to Aaron and to the entire assembly of the children of Israel to the wilderness of Paran at Kadesh, and brought back the report to them and the entire assembly, and they showed them the fruit of the land.
Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam asher natan lanu Torah emet.
Thank you.
Amen. Once again, we can all be seated.
Okay, I feel like I got the hard part over with now. To each and every one of you here today, I would just like to say thank you for being here and being a part of my Bat Mitzvah. This is not the week of my birthday. In fact, the day that I was born and the year I was born, it was actually Yom Kippur. And so when my mom was giving birth to me, it was actually the High Holy Day of the Day of Atonement. So that's pretty special to me. But this portion, Shalak, I happen to had made an outline for this teaching God gave to me like 2 years ago. So I'm really excited to be here today to be able to share this with you. And I know that in Jewish tradition, a girl usually has her bat mitzvah at the age of 12, but about 16 years late by my calculation, so that's not too bad. When we were on our way here this morning, Leonardo reminded me that I'm here to bring a message. And my mom, when she tells this story that before I was born, she was going to name me Bobby Joe, and she said that when I was born, then she said I looked more like an Angela. So an angel, you know, is the root of Angela, and an angel is a messenger. So it was just kind of all fitting. So, and I thank the Lord for bringing me here to the tabernacle to expose me to the Jewish roots of the Bible, and it just made the whole entire scripture make a lot more sense to me. I felt like this is truth. So, without further ado, I'd like you all to think about what you think about when you picture the world before the fall. What do you picture? A lush, beautiful garden full of brilliant flowers and fruit trees. A place of peace and tranquility. A place our Father created so he could walk hand in hand with the people he created. Now let's liken that Garden of Eden to an ornate, one-of-a-kind mirror, a highly polished work of art. The day that Adam and Eve partook of the tree of knowledge of good and evil, that mirror shattered into millions and millions of pieces. The reality is that that mirror can be put back together. All that has to be done is all those little broken pieces everywhere have to be found and united together again. Tikkun Olam, repair of the world. When we have the light of Messiah and we shine it around, it soon reflects upon those broken pieces. And that is when we have the opportunity to be a part of that tikkun, or repair. What began in a garden will end in a garden. If you go to the back of the book in Revelation, there's a garden with a glorious tree of life. And as you see throughout the scriptures and you study them, you start to identify that it is God's intention to make this repair. And as we study this week's Torah portion, we see one of these attempts of the Holy One to gather his people to himself, to a land flowing with milk and honey. Those of you who attend my Beit Midrash class, you'll know that I like to start my teachings with a story, so I'm not going to change the way I do things. So this story actually comes from the Midrash, and it didn't have a title, so I titled it, The Prince Not Convinced. It goes nicely along with the Torah portion Shalak. The prince had come of age. A suitable bride had to be found. His father chose for him a girl whom he carefully selected from all those who were eligible. The father informed the son, "I have a wonderful girl for you. She is wise, she is beautiful, accomplished, and noble stock. She has all the qualities anyone could desire." The son was not convinced. "Let me meet her for myself." The king was greatly aggravated that the son did not trust him. He thought, if I refuse his request, he will assume that she is ugly. I will therefore let him meet her, so that he can convince himself that she is indeed beautiful. However, since he did not believe me, I will not let him marry her. I will reserve this girl for his son instead. At the heart of this week's Torah portion, Shalach, lies the most famous episode of espionage gone wrong known to man. The pillar of cloud stopped at Kadesh Barnea on the southern border of Canaan. Moses sent out the 12th man to the land of Eretz Israel to scout it out. The men brought back with them, after 40 days, samples of abundant produce that they had found growing there. Caleb and Joshua urged the people to rise up and follow the pillar of cloud and fire into the land the Holy One was giving them. The other 10 let fear get the best of them. The other 10 prophesied doom, gloom, and disaster. Their negativity played havoc on the people's fleshly emotions. The result? The children of Israel found themselves wandering for the next 38 and a half years in the wilderness. Do not fear appears in Scripture a grand total of 365 times. This is the primary focus of this week's portion. The Holy One knows that whatever or whoever we allow to make us afraid, we give power to. When we are afraid or worried, it interrupts our communication with our Heavenly Father. When we are afraid, it distracts us from the mission to which He has called us. Not to mention, as is evident in portion Shalach, when we are afraid, we delay, at least for a season, if not for a generation, the outworking of His grand plan for our household and for our bloodline. Just a few Torah portions ago, Hashem spoke to Moses. He said, "Go, ascend from here, you and the people whom you brought up from the land of Egypt, to the land which I swore to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob, saying, I shall give it to your offspring. I shall send an angel ahead of you. I shall drive out the Canaanite, the Amorite, the Hittite, the Perizzite, the Hivite, and the Jebusite to a land that flows with milk and honey." Exodus 33:1-3. If you notice, this land is a gift. Our Western minds think of a gift as a one-time transference. But in the Hebrew, the operative verb is natan, nun, tav, final nun. The first time we see this word in Scripture is Genesis 1, verse 17. Here we see yitan, a derivative of natan, used to describe what the luminaries of the heavens were designed to do in relation to the earth. The sun, the moon, and the stars were set in the firmament to give light on the earth. These luminaries engage in a process of transmission and delivery, an ongoing process that continues in a divinely ordained sequence of ebbs and flows. All of the gifts of the Holy One initiate a covenant furthering process. The result of every gift of the Holy One is to establish a permanent partnership between the Holy One Himself, the recipient of the gift, and the subject matter of the gift. None of the bridegroom's gifts are once and for all. They are gifts that keep on giving. Now, it seems important that we get a picture of what's happening here at the beginning of Parsha Shalach. The children of Israel had just recently left the mountain of Hashem in the last portion. Now, the Chumash states, when the people left Sinai, which is not far from populated areas, to venture into the unknown wilderness, they grew frantic. They acted as if they were truly in pain and had a right to complain. Their moods and spirits were that of rebellion and self-pity. A once spiritually elevated community had now reverted to the corrupt nature of their existence in Egypt. Welcome to the wilderness of Paran. Paran is first mentioned in the Torah as the barren area between Beersheba and Egypt, to which Hagar and Ishmael settled after being cast out of Abraham's camp in Genesis 21, 20 and 21. Now by this time, Ishmael of course is deceased, but his descendants are still very much alive. This is Ishmael's world. This is where Ishmael's spirit still lives. Let me refresh your memory of Ishmael's attitude and approach to life. Genesis 21, 8 through 10. The child, Isaac, grew and was weaned. Abraham made a great feast on the day that Isaac was weaned. Sarah saw the son of Hagar, the Egyptian, whom she'd borne to Abraham, mocking. So she said to Abraham, "Drive out this slave woman with her son, for the son of this slave woman shall not be heir with my son." Now, if you remember, when Hagar realized that she was pregnant with Ishmael, Hagar assumed an attitude of entitlement. Unwilling to accept the discipline of Sarah for her behavior, Hagar ran away toward the land of Egypt. But before she could get there, the angel of Hashem found her and prophesied to her about the child in her womb. Genesis 16, 12, "And he shall be a wild ass of a man, his hand against everyone and everyone's hand against him." This prophecy, of course, came true. Last week, we got a foretaste of how negatively charged this atmosphere really was. The people complained about the manna. They wanted meat to eat. So God gave them an abundance of meat and a month's supply of quail. Then Miriam spoke against Moses. My friends, Ishmael's world is about to get even more treacherous. Consider also who Ishmael chose for a wife. Yes, it was an Egyptian, just like his mother. The spirit of the land of Paran, mocking, untamable, argumentative, combative, entitled, a spirit that tends to devalue the land of Israel, choose foreign ways over the ways of Hashem, and blaming the faithful remnant of the covenant for their problems. Sound familiar? Welcome to the wilderness. The opening verse of the portion, Shalach, is Hashem spoke to Moses, "Send forth men, if you please." Shalach Lacha in the Hebrew. Shalach is actually made up of three Hebrew letters, Shin, Lamed, Ket. The letter Shin represents flames rising upward, teeth to destroy, to devour, or Hashem. The Lamed represents a staff to teach, to guide, to urge forward. The Ket shows a fence, an inner room, a chamber, or to protect. The first the word Shalach is used in Scripture is Genesis 3, verse 22. Then the Holy One said, "Behold, the man has become like one of us, to know good and evil. Now lest he put out his hand and take also of the tree of life and eat and live forever." Three different portions use the root Shalach. Earlier this year, we studied the portion Beishalach, when he sent, an account of the children of Israel being sent out of Egypt to become a chosen nation. This week, portion Shalach, send forth. And when we get back around to the book of Genesis, or Bereshit in Hebrew, we will study Vaishlach, meaning he sent. Here, Jacob will reach out to his brother Esau, wrestle with the Holy One, get a name change, and then face his brother. Shalach is also where the word apostle comes from. Shaliach, an agent, an emissary, a sent out one. In our Brit Hadashah portion, or New Testament portion, Yeshua sends out his emissaries, or apostles, as sheep in the midst of wolves. Could it be that Shalach, or the idea of being sent, is that the Holy One, Shin, will guide you, Lamed, and protect you, Ket? the Holy One's idea. The implication here is that Hashem gave Moses permission to send the men, but left the decision up to him. In Deuteronomy 1, 21 through 23, the Torah provides further information on the sequence of events leading up to the mission. The sages explain that it was the people who came to Moses and asked him to dispatch the men and report back to them. Moses consulted Hashem, who said, "I've already told you the land is good land, but I shall now give you a chance to doubt my word if you wish." Now let's look at the rest of verse 2 of our portion. Numbers 13, verse 2. "Send forth men, if you please, and let them spy out the land of Canaan that I give to the children of Israel. One man, each from his father's tribe, shall you send, every one a leader among them." The Hebrew word that our English Bibles translate as spy is yateru, yod, tav, vav, resh. The Hebrew verb at the root of yateru is tur, tav, vav, resh, which means to meander about, especially for purposes of trade or reconnoitering. Now this verb is where our English word tour or tourist comes from. In human planning, spying, checking things out by exploring them, can often be a significant benefit. If you're planning to start a business, or if your army is planning on launching an offensive, or if you want to find the best price on a car or a home, spying is the best way to obtain intelligence on how to base your decision. Potential entrepreneurs check out the market area and the competition. Armies send out intelligence to observe or monitor the enemy's location. Potential car owners check out what's under the hood of a car to check for mechanical issues. And probable homeowners inspect the foundation of the house for cracks or termites. Now, it's one thing to gather data pertinent to your investigation, but it's quite another to make sense of that data, draw the right conclusions and assumptions from it, and make the decisions on the basis of it. The men chosen to be sent out to tour or spy out the land were to gather intelligence to satisfy their curiosity. The men were not sent to weigh the pros and cons of the land. They were not to base their judgments on temporal, fleshly matters, which is what we get from spying. Instead, these men, as well as us as believers, are to base our judgments and decisions upon eternal, unseen matters taught to us by the Ruach HaKodesh, or the Holy Spirit. This is exactly why Moses exhorts us to meditate upon the Torah as we sit in our homes, as we walk by the way, when we lie down, and when we rise up. And as Paul interpreted the prophet Isaiah, "Eye has not seen, nor ear heard, nor have entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for those who love him." 1 Corinthians 2, verse 9, paraphrasing Isaiah 64, 4. Yeshua warns his apostles before he sends them out on their mission of the persecutions that are coming. He assures his sent out ones not to worry about how or what they should speak. Quote, "For it will be given to you in that hour what you should speak, for it is not you who speak, but the Spirit of your Father who speaks in you." Matthew 10, 19 and 20. The Torah tells us that Moses sent out the 12 to, one, explore and map out the terrain of the land. Take note of and report on the fruitfulness of the land. To bring back some of its produce for the people to see and sample, and to report on the people they found inhabiting the land, their natures, and the structures of their society. When the scouts returned after their 40-day tour of the land, they should have reported to Moses, the one who sent them. But instead, they made their comments into a loud public declaration. We all know very well the message that the scouts returned with, a message that provoked fear into the children of Israel. But the non-verbal message the spies returned with is the one they totally missed. First of all 12 men who went out came back very alive and very well. The land had not devoured them, nor had its inhabitants hardened one hair on their heads. Truth be told, the inhabitants were more afraid of the children of Israel, because news of how Hashem had conquered the Pharaoh and his army had spread throughout the land. Second, the scouts brought back an abundant saplings of grapes, figs, and pomegranates. Now let's consider what these fruits symbolize. Pri Hagafen, Hebrew for the fruit of the vine. Our Torah text tells us that in the valley of Eshkol, the scouts had found marvelous grapes. We are told that they brought back to Kadesh Barnea with them a cluster of grapes so large and full of fruit that it had to be brought back on a double pole. 8 men had to carry this humongous cluster of grapes. Now on the surface, these grapes mean that the land, at least the valley of Eshkol, is productive, a good land for vineyards. But if you look beyond the surface, grapes in this kind of an abundance symbolize joy and a cause for celebration to be shared with families and communities. Before the scouts even opened their mouths to speak, creation spoke, saying, "Come into my beautiful garden." Hatani, Hebrew for the fig. The next fruit mentioned is the fig. In Eretz Israel, figs ripen in 2 crops, an early crop in June and a late crop in August. The second crop is obtained by pruning the branches after the early crop comes in, bringing about a second blossoming, or a double portion. What do figs symbolize? First of all, they symbolize prosperity. 1 Chronicles 12, 38-40, figs were employed in the celebration of David's coronation as king of all Israel. Figs also represent good health. Isaiah speaks of this in 2 Kings 20, verse 7, and Isaiah 38, verse 21, where a poultice of figs were used to heal King Hezekiah. Figs also represent a sign of peace. Yeshua specifically mentioned the appearance of leaves on the fig tree as a sign of his return, Mark 13, 28 through 30. And of course, they represent security in the aspect that Adam and Eve sewed together fig leaves to make themselves a covering. All this and a double portion, this fruit should have spoken volumes. Hal Ramon, Hebrew for the pomegranate. A bright red, hard-shelled fruit with what resembles a crown where the stem attaches. The pomegranate symbolizes the fullness of Torah. Its many seeds correspond to the many mitzvot of Torah lifestyle, and its rich, flavorful pulp correspond to the blessing of Hashem upon the life of those who honor him by holding fast to his covenant. Its sweet nectar is that which those who know Messiah as bridegroom share with him. The pomegranate declared that the land was indeed a place where the people of the Holy One could become all they were created to be and model the lifestyle of Torah. The pomegranates were also inscribed in the hem of the robe of the high priest, speaking, "In this land you can fulfill your destiny as my kingdom of priests." Now all 3 fruits together at one time was even more glorious. The grape, the fig, and the pomegranate together symbolize the fullness of the kingdom of Messiah. Zechariah 3, verse 8 through 10 reads, "Behold, I will bring forth my servant the branch, and I will remove the iniquity of that land in one day. In that day, says the Holy One of Hosts, every man will invite his neighbor to sit under his vine and under his fig tree." Consider also Micah chapter 4, verses 1 through 4. But at the end of days, the mountain of the Holy One will be established as chief of the mountains and will be raised above the hills. Peoples will flow up to it. Then many nations will go and say, "Come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob. Then he will direct us in his ways, and we will walk in his paths." For the Torah will go forth from Zion, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He will judge between many peoples and decide for mighty nations far off. They will beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning shears. Nation will not lift up sword against nation, nor will they learn of war again. But each man will sit under his vine and under his fig tree with no one causing terror, for the mouth of Adonai Zebaot has spoken. The message spoken by creation at the bidding of the Holy One, long before a single scout uttered a single word, was, "Come into my garden and I will give you rest." Personally, this week's portion of Shalach reminds me that as we travel through our own personal wilderness, remember that it is a desert, it is dry and it's hot, and it lacks all the comforts we desire. But we must continue to guide, to guard our hearts and our minds and our souls. As sons and daughters of the Most High, we must transcend the petty arguments, the offenses, the controversies, and the conflicts of the day. When we seek the Holy One, we have to see beyond the facade of reality into his true inner nature. The outward appearance of the bridegroom's Torah seems to contain intricate laws, heavy, harsh judgments, heavy burdens, and strict obedience. But when one prays for vision and understanding, they realize that the true meaning of the Torah is all about love, grace, and mercy. The spies or scouts, they didn't see the whole picture. They didn't look into the heavens. They didn't fully understand their mission into the land. And at times, neither do we. Think about this. The word Yatiru, the word for spy, shares the same root as the word Torah. The scouts were being commanded to look inwardly with depth, to seek instruction, to see the inner essence of the land. When we walk through this world, we need not look at the Holy One or ourselves or others as tourists might, without noticing details. We are not meant to just sightsee or even slight We are meant to wade deep, to live lives, to speak words and engage in behaviors that release light and salt. And we must do this with courage and determination in the face of self-doubt. After all, there is a gift that awaits us, a garden.
And, of course, aspect of his husband and his wife. Let's all extend our hand and write in a blessing toward Angela. Avinu Shebashamayim, our Father in heaven, Lord, we give you thanks and praise for this day. And indeed, your daughter Angela has become a Bat Mitzvah, a daughter of your commandments. Publicly speaking from not only your Torah, but also lifting up your son Yeshua, the Torah made flesh, the living word, as hers. Congregational family, we extend holy hands toward her, and we thank you, O Lord God, that from this day on, from this day forward, Angela will never be the same, because you have brought upon her an increase in the anointing of the Ruach HaKodesh in her life. We thank you, O Lord God, that the scripture says that the eye has not seen, nor the ear heard, nor the mind imagined things that God has in store for those who truly love him, and he reveals it by the Ruach HaKodesh and the Holy Spirit. Thank you, O Lord, that your banner over Angela now and forever will be the love of God that never, never fails. And Father, I thank you that she already has become like the great women of the Bible, like Sarah, Rebecca, Rachel, and Leah, demonstrating today also the heart of Ruth. And Father, we thank you above all that you will continue to conform her into the image of your son, Yeshua. Lord, we speak a blessing to Angela and Leonardo. Thank you again for their marriage to one another. And I thank you that Leonardo will be a strong priest over his household. We give you all the praise and all the glory. Hallelujah. That Angela is the head, not the tail. She is above and not below. All the blessings of God are yea and amen to her in the Messiah, Yeshua. And we give you praise and glory today that your blessing will abide forever. For you have said, through this blessing, you will put your name upon the children of Israel. Yivadechecha Adonai v'yishmarecha Ya'er Adonai panavalecha likunecha Yisa Adonai panavalecha Semlecha Shalom. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Perfect peace, B'Shem Yeshua HaMashiach, the Sar Shalom, the Prince of Peace. Amen and amen. And if you think Angela did a good job today, thank you. Let's go out rejoicing as we find the song, Rejoice, O Daughter of Zion, on the overhead. Let's have the dance team come back up. Those of you who want to join in the celebration, come down to the front as well. unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Perfect peace, B'Shem Yeshua HaMashiach, the Tsar Shalom, the Prince of Peace. Altogether, that thy way may be known upon the earth, and thy salvation among all the nations. Amen. And again, if you love the Lord, give him one more great peace. Let's go downstairs for some food and fellowship. And again, Shabbat Shalom. God bless you.